everybody this morning. So as I was trying to think about what to say, I just wanted to read the whole book of Colossians to you. No, I'm just kidding. It's a really good book. I'm having a hard time deciding where to go, so be led by the Holy Spirit here, and we will talk about the sufficiency of Christ. Let's see. As you have therefore received Christ, even Jesus the Lord, so walk, regulate your lives, and conduct yourselves in union with and conformity to him. Have the roots of your being firmly and deeply planted in him, fixed and founded in him, being continually built up in him, becoming increasingly more confirmed and established in the faith, just as you were taught, and abounding and overflowing in it with thanksgiving. See to it that no one carries you off as spoil or makes you yourselves captive by his so-called philosophy or intellectualism and vain deceit, his idle fantasies and plain nonsense, following human traditions, men's ideas of the material rather than the spiritual world, just crude notions following the rudimentary and elemental teachings of the universe and disregarding the teachings of Christ the Messiah. For in him, the whole fullness of deity, the Godhead, continues to dwell in bodily form, giving complete expression of the divine nature. And you are in him, made full, and having come to the fullness of life in Christ, you too are filled with the Godhead, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and reach full spiritual stature. And he is the head of all rule and authority, every angelic principality and power. So, that's full of good news for us this morning. Amen. When we remain rooted and grounded in him, then all of the rest of it just comes. We are filled with all of the power of the Godhead. That blows my mind every time I read it. And out of everything in Colossians, I was really moved this morning by Paul's prayers for this church that he had never even seen or met. He'd never met these people. But he said, I pray for you continually. And it is my job to pray for you. And I was just really moved by that this morning, that he's our example. Paul is one of our examples of someone who got it, who understood how to be rooted and grounded. This was a man who lived the majority of his adult life in jail in Rome. But he ministered powerfully. And so I guess I was just moved to say, no matter what our circumstances, no matter what our personal struggles, our ministry is powerful. Because we are filled with the Godhead. We are rooted and grounded and firmly planted in him. And we are our ministry, our influence in other people's lives is unlimited. It's only limited by our ability and our willingness to reach out and share the good news that we have been given. And there's nothing that the Lord requires of us to seal us, to give us a license, to make us prepared or ready. We don't get a degree, we don't get a seal, but we get the Holy Spirit himself who lives in us, and that is all the authority, all the power that we need. We don't need to earn it. We don't need to know all the Bible. We don't have to have it memorized cover to cover, but we do need to open our mouths and we need to share what God has done. And that is how he is glorified, and that is how our ministry is it grows, right? And it flows. And the more that we allow God himself to flow out of us, the more he flows into us. And that is the beauty of living and moving and having our being in him. That when we share, when we give, when we open ourselves, he opens himself even more to us. And those mysteries become just part of our life. The mystery, the hope of glory. The mystery of the Godhead, of our God, our Creator God, our Savior God, who wants to come and dwell in us, who wants to have himself revealed through us, who wants to save this world through us, mere mortals, imperfect creatures. We can, if we were to sit down and make a list of all the reasons we shouldn't and all the reasons we should, there's only one reason we should. There's only one. Jesus. It is finished. Do we really believe that it is finished? It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives within me. When I look at you, all I want to see, Paul told us, all I want to see in you is Christ and Christ crucified. That's all we need to see. And when we look at the world through those eyes, when we look at each other through those eyes, we are all victorious. And we are all holy and righteous and perfect, accepted in the beloved. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. And how easy is it at this time of year to say Merry Christmas and start a whole conversation? Because sometimes that's pretty controversial. I was at Michael's Christmas party yesterday, and I, you know, inserted myself in the process like I always do, hand out gifts to the kids. And I start saying Merry Christmas, and I'm like, can I say that? Because I know that he's had grievances filed against him for eating a ham sandwich in his office, you know? So I'm like, can I say that? And his staff was like, sure. And especially if they say it to you first.
Yes.
Michael might have put the kibosh on that later. When there was a Muslim family sitting right in front of me. But, you know, sometimes that's all it takes. Merry Christmas. It is a joyous season. And we are all able to celebrate the reasons for the season. Anybody have any prayer requests or testimonies? Yeah, Roberto.
It's good to be back. It's been a very eventful past few months. But now the dust is starting to settle, so that's good. I'm very grateful to be here for those that were able to share our special day of our wedding. Thank you. Those that weren't able to attend, it's okay. I don't know how it is.
Peter. Just a couple things. Situation at work's not very good. Just some weird things happening. All my projects but one have been taken off my plate and given to somebody else. And I asked my boss about it. She wouldn't respond to me. So I'm not quite sure what's going on there. And just I'm going to be working today just trying to get caught up on stuff. Also, I need prayer to have time and start the vision that God's given me for this new company to start. It's just, but it's hard to do that when you're
I have a new lady through my cancer society named Paige, and after her chemo the other day, her skin started peeling off of her hands and off of her legs. She's having to wear gloves like 24/7 just to keep the skin on, so we could remember her in prayer. I appreciate it.
Did you have something out of it?
Last week I asked for prayer for my sister-in-law who was
morning? I think that we should gather together and pray. There's some needs today that I think that I don't want to pray up here. I want to come pray together. So for everybody that asked for prayer or has prayed for someone, come on up, and then we're just going to gather around here in $100. If you want to come up to your sister-in-law, if you want to come up to her,
thank you.
Thank you. Sure. that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God. In Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with His feathers, and under His wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For He shall give His angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear up in their hands. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet. Because He has set His love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he hath known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. When we pray in our homes, when we pray with our families, pray against the spirit of infirmity. Pray against the attacks of the enemy, against our body of believers, against the people that we know and love. Remember all of us, every one of us, when we pray for our own families, when we pray for our own needs, remember the needs of the body. Pray for our pastor's wife, and pray for every member of this body. We need to pray and remember each other. Maybe that's why I was so moved by Paul today, who prayed for people he had never even met. We know and love each other. Let's gird up together. Let's link arms together, and let's take a stand against the enemy together. We do not have to deal with these things. We do not have to take these attacks from the enemy. We serve a God who says all things are possible. We serve a God who rose from the dead, who conquered death, hell, and the grave. What do we have to fear? Who can be against us? Nathan said it when he was praying. Cancer has to bow at the name of Jesus. Death has to bow at the name of Jesus. Sickness and disease has to bow at the name of Jesus. Everything needs to bow at the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name. Praise the Lord. If you brought a cell phone with you, please remember to turn the ringer down this morning. And this Friday, December 9th, 7 p.m., Eastern Gate, House of Prayer.
Going to focus for the reason of the season, plus the needs that you saw tonight, but we will also pray for, and those needs that haven't been brought forth today, family, friends, relatives, those at work, whatever, come to the altar, and let's deal with these things. Pray for America. She's still in transition. A lot of junk going on. Pray for Israel. We will have communion again. We will have it every Eastern Gate House of Prayer. Last time it turned into Holy Ghost Day. It just was about the blood of Jesus. It was all over the place. Voices of joy and praise. You probably heard them singing the rehearsal sing yesterday. This morning you were hearing it. They were here yesterday, and some of them will be coming this Friday night also, just to fellowship and love on the Lord with us. So please come. Let's come and adore Him.
And this is a word that I don't remember if it was Wednesday or last Sunday. I guess I haven't shared yet. But the Lord impressed upon me that there have been so many battles this year. There have been so many attacks this year. Hang on. Because this year is about to end, and a new year is about ready to begin. And this next year, January 1st, 2017, is going to be a year where we're reaping. We are reaping, and that's why the enemy is coming so hard, because all the promises, all the seeds, the fruit is coming and the harvest is coming. We will do nothing but reap the blessings of God in 2017. And if nothing else, hang on. Hold fast. You are rooted and grounded in Christ.
Amen.
And just know that good things are coming. Good things are coming. Blessings in Jesus' name. Amen. I know, Lord, it's not the respecter of the calendar, but it's still, season is changing. Season is changing.
Oh, that reminds me, yesterday when the ladies were rehearsing, there was a split that happened with them when they were out doing ministry, and Susan, the founder of the group and stuff, was brokenhearted. She was crying in the parking lot about 3 weeks, 4 weeks ago. But the Lord faithfully restored others in to take others' places, and then some. And when they were singing yesterday, it confirms that after the beginning of the year, we talked about the new beginnings and stuff, there will be a women's conference here. And I mentioned that to them yesterday, and they was just all over themselves and stuff. So be prepared, ladies. And guys, you can come too, because if you've ever been to a women's conference, they get crazy.
Well, not just at women's conferences,
yeah.
But okay. Let's speak the word this morning. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? Yes, Lord. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Yes, Lord. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. Yes, yes. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Yes, Lord. John and Ron. Ron, do you want to come help with the offering this morning, please? Ron, can you ask the blessing, please? Yes, blessing. Thank you.
Father, we thank you for the fellowship we have here, the body of Christ. Thank you that you are blessing us. You've anointed us. You've given us strength. You've given us power. You've given all the divine promises that you have made in Christ. We thank you for this offering. We ask you to bless this offering. And it will meet the needs of this body.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Glory. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Y'all ready to worship the Lord? And being in the last quarter of my years, if unless the Lord tarries, will have to be replaced then. And it's people like her, they're going to be replacing me. So I challenged her to come and stand with me, just like my granddaughter Shaylee did. And I know she's shy, but that's okay. We're all family here. So as the Lord leads.
Thank you. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for what you've already done in this service, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We bless you this morning. I am the God that inhabits your praises. Though I dwell within you, I draw nigh you when you worship. I am the eternal God. I am your refuge. And under me, you find safety. Even under my everlasting arms, I thrust out the enemy before you and shall say, destroy them. Hallelujah. Let's all thank the Lord right now. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah, Lord.
Hallelujah, Lord. We bless you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that our enemies are your enemies.
Hallelujah.
Sickness, disease,
hallelujah,
heartache, pain, suffering are the enemies of the cross, and you have defeated them.
Amen.
And we stand in that victory today. And declare it in your mighty name.
Yes, hallelujah, amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Your name is above all names.
Praise God. Praise God. Give the Lord a big hand clap. Praise God.
Yes, hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. God bless you. You may be seated. Thank you, worship team. Mike, as always. Thank you, everybody, for sharing. Thank you. Praise God. Thank you, Rita, for being sensitive to the Lord. Thank you, Mike Gerlach, for shoveling the walk. Praise the Lord. Saved your feet, but it saved my back. Praise God. Thank you, buddy. I appreciate it. Praise the Lord. Okay, Sunday school kids, you may be dismissed to go downstairs. What I'd like to share with you this morning, I don't want to be misunderstood, although I usually am because I'm not that good at expressing myself, praise the Lord, but I want to talk to you about communion, but in a way that it was interesting they brought up having communion on Friday at House of Prayer, but I'm not saying what I'm going to say. I'm not saying, I don't want you to think that somehow I'm saying you shouldn't take communion, or that that ritual is something that we don't want to be involved in, because we do. But I do want you to understand that that symbolism that Jesus talked about is supposed to be our daily reality. And we can turn it into a ritual to where we celebrate it once a month or once a year or once every 6 months or once whenever we feel like it and think that that is what it's about. It's about remembering him and what he's done. Yes. And what that reality is then in us. So we do it for that purpose, but our lives ought to be lived out of that reality. So we go back and remind ourselves of what our lives really are all about. That's what we do when we have communion. But it's so easy to turn these things into rituals and into rites to where they just become a function without any real reality.
Amen.
Just something we do and so forth. So the manifestation should happen in our lives all the time.
Amen.
And we remind ourselves and others of that by taking communion.
Yes.
On a regular or not so regular basis. Y'all know you can take communion at home. You don't need a preacher or anybody. I mean, that's something we can just do anytime. So that's what I'm going to talk to you about. Praise the Lord. But first I want to just say a couple of things that I mentioned Wednesday night. For those of you that weren't here, you need to know this. That I'm a perfectionist with a procrastinator complex. Someday I'm going to be awesome. Just lighten up the mood here a little bit, praise God. How many of you ever, you know, you remember Uri Geller? Anybody remember him, the one who used to bend spoons and all that stuff? On all those who believe in psychokinesis, raise my hand.
Yeah.
Ooh, rough tonight, praise the Lord. I'm just trying to break the mood here a little bit. This doesn't quench the Holy Ghost, okay? He's a little bigger than all of us, praise the Lord. I'm just trying to lighten things up a little. My wife knows this, but not all of you do, that I speak three languages fluently. English, profanity, and sarcasm. All right, praise God. You don't want to go there with me this morning, so. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Verses 23 through 26. 1 Corinthians 11, 23 through 26. I love that perfectionist, procrastinator complex, because it really is true. Someday. Praise God. I just like language. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup, when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye, as oft as ye drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come. So Satan wants us to focus on us, on our failures, on our flesh, on our rituals. And Jesus wants us to focus on him, Christ in us, his life. John chapter 6, verses 48 through 51. John 6, 48 through 51. I am that bread of life. Your fathers did eat manna in the wilderness and are dead. This is the bread which cometh down from heaven, that a man may eat thereof and not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. So Jesus says, remember me. Your life is provided for, and it's hid in me. That, church, is incarnation, not transubstantiation. It doesn't literally change. It already has. It's in us. So, unlike some religions who actually believe that when they take the communion, it literally becomes the body and the blood of Jesus. That's transubstantiation. That isn't what we're talking about. We're talking about incarnation. When we remember who we are in Christ, he manifests. Now, you may have a communion service and something tremendous happens, but that's the reality that we're supposed to be living in all the time, not just when we have a communion service. Amen. See what I'm saying? So I'm trying to get us, and this is why I told some jokes, because you're going to think I'm mad before I'm done, but I'm not. I'm trying to get us past a lot of the fallacies and a lot of the rituals and the religion that we think do something when they don't. This isn't transubstantiation, it's manifestation, and it manifests in us because that bread of life is in us. Amen. Praise the Lord. Those are symbols. The reality already exists in us when we were born again. We received that bread that came down from heaven, and it gave us everlasting life, and it provides for every need that we have from now on. Romans chapter 8, verse 32. He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Manna, the bread of life, right? Let's go back to Exodus chapter 16, verses 14 and 15. Exodus 16, verses 14 and 15. You know, I was born again in a Jesus name, Pentecostal holiness church. So I know all about ritual, believe me. But it does absolutely nothing without the substance, without the reality. And that's what we're interested in. We're not interested in pursuing more religion or advancing some particular belief system outside of Christ himself. It's the only way we can ever be successful. It's the only way we can have what the Bible says. You don't get it by just going through the motions and thinking that, you know, I had this feeling or that. Look, that's all good. But we want the reality. We experienced just a taste of it here. Tongues and interpretation. That's a reality. We don't know. We don't know when it's going to happen. We can't set up a schedule and say, hey, we're having tongues and interpretation tonight. Everybody show up. It happens by the Spirit. And that's what we want, because then we know it's God. And when the dew that lay was gone up, behold, upon the face of the wilderness there lay a small round thing, as small as the hoarfrost on the ground. And when the children of Israel saw it, they said one to another, it is manna, for they wist not what it was. They said it's manna because they didn't know what it was. And Moses said unto them, this is the bread which the Lord hath given you to eat. In other words, it's God's provision for your need. When Jesus said, I am the bread of life, he meant that he provides for all life. He wasn't telling us, do this. He said, when you do it, remember me. Don't make this the focus, make me the focus. Amen. The people said, what is it? And you know, I mentioned this Wednesday night, but I'm going to repeat myself. God's mystery always comes as revelation to humans. It doesn't come as an answer to our questions, because our questions are idiotic to God. It's like when your three-year-old or grandchild, little kid, asks you questions. They're stupid. I mean, they don't make sense. So we try to answer them. But the truth is, we speak to them what's revelation to them, because they don't know. And that's the way it is with God. We ask questions, but rarely does God really answer our questions. He gives us revelation instead. Because our revelations, our questions are really the wrong questions, because we don't know what questions to ask. Praise the Lord. I'm saying human questions are never going to set the agenda in God's revelation. He has a purpose he wants to reveal, and he's going to reveal it by revelation regardless of what questions we're asking. God always takes the initiative. Question, in this case, the question should have been, who is it? Not what is it? Right? Because now we have hindsight. We can see after all the scriptures, Jesus said, I'm the bread that came down from heaven. That was simply a symbol. And yes, it did some things, but it was a type of me. So their question shouldn't have been, what is it? Their question should have been, who is it? But they didn't know enough to ask the right question. So God gives them revelation in the person of Jesus Christ. Amen. The deeper answer then would have been, it's providence. But see, that wasn't the question they asked, so that wasn't the answer they got. Providence isn't a word that we generally use much today. It's not part of our vocabulary as a rule. What is providence? Providence means gracious provision. Romans 8:32 again, if you will, Sheila. We just read this a moment ago, but it's worth looking at again in context here. He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? That's providence. Everything, all things. Providence is God's detailed, on purpose, daily, continuous provision for us. It's called Christ in you. Amen. Providence is God's holiness, his omnipotence, his unchanging, unconditional love, his infinite grace and mercy. And it's all revealed in the person of Jesus Christ. The purpose isn't just to improve lives, although God wants to improve lives. It's to know God and to be one with God. That's God's agenda. Providence is a continuous gift that flows from the reality of knowing Jesus Christ. He is the bread of life. It isn't something we do once in a while in a particular service. It's our reality. It's who we are. It's what we are. To diminish, to do anything other than that, it diminishes it. Again, I'm not against communion. I'm just saying, let's be adults. Let's grow up and realize we're not like Jesus said, you know, this generation is like children playing in the marketplace. You know, play this tune, do this thing. All the business is being transacted up here. They're down here playing some other game. They don't even understand really what's going on. They're playing there, but they don't really get what the purpose of the marketplace is. There's transactions taking place all the time, but it's all above their head. I don't want that to be our testimony. I don't want that to be our generation. We need to stand up and take part.
Amen.
Get involved in the business that's being transacted. This is heavenly business.
Yes.
This is transformational business.
Come on.
It's manna. It's Jesus. The Lord sent the manna, but he didn't serve him breakfast in bed.
Right.
They had to get up and go get it.
Yep.
Every day. And that's what I'm talking about this morning. It's not. I'm not talking about religious duties. I'm saying every day we got to be aware.
Yes.
We have to be aware of what that communion symbolism is about. That we have this provision. We have this healing. We have this deliverance. It's in us. It's with us. It's a part of us. And that's the reason for communion. As often as you do this, he doesn't say do it often. He just says whenever you do it, as often as you do it. And remember that I died on the cross to give you all of this,
right,
so that it's your possession now.
Yes.
It belongs to you.
Yes.
It's a part of you.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
So we can We can have that experience. We can have that reality every day, all day. Because it's a continuous, constant, ongoing, on purpose blessing from God that never ends. It just doesn't come every once in a while when we're in the right place at the right time and everything is set up just perfectly. It's there. It's available all the time. We just have to be conscious of it. We have to remember it. It's manna. They had to collect it. They had to eat it. They had to digest it.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That's what we do. That's why he said, take, eat. This is my body. Eat it. Get it. Eat it. Digest it. Make it a part of you. That's what our food becomes, a part of us, right?
Right.
The same thing is true with the Word of God. The Word of God is Jesus. Let's not separate. He is our spiritual food. And you cannot dumb it down. Well, you can, but it's stupid. Ergo, dumb it down, I guess. So, you know what I'm saying. Let's not do that. Let's not turn everything into a religious exercise when this is about a relationship.
Right. Amen.
Luke chapter 4, verse 2. See, so many of the things that we do, you know, religiously, and everything religious isn't bad, I'm just saying. The problem is it always leads us away from Jesus into some human activity instead of making the focus Him. Being 40 days tempted of the devil, and in those days he did eat nothing. And when they were ended, he afterward hungered. Jesus had been in the wilderness all of that time, that whole 40 days, hadn't eaten anything. Right?
Right.
There's a metaphor here. There's a teaching here. And here's the secret to surviving in our wilderness. Matthew chapter 4, verse 4. Because we all got them. We wake up in a wilderness every day. We got to remind ourselves who and what we are in Christ. But he answered and said, it's written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Okay, now that leads us to 1 Corinthians again, chapter 11, verses 23 through 26, where we started. 1 Corinthians 11, 23 through 26. He said, man doesn't live by bread alone, not natural bread, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Jesus. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, take and eat, this is my body, which is broken for you, and this do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup, when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood, this do ye, as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread, drink this cup, you show the Lord's death till he comes. He's saying, this is a metaphor.
Right.
This isn't what I'm interested in. I'm interested in you understanding what I'm talking about.
Right.
The reason for this, not the thing itself.
Amen.
John chapter 6 again, verse 48 to 51. Do it, but as often as you do it. I mean, if you have to do it every day, three or four times a day, in order to keep this reality in your mind, then do it. But if you don't have to, if it doesn't take that for you, just whenever you do it, remind yourself that this is the reason I'm doing it. Not because I'm trying to get something to happen, but because something can be happening all the time if I would just be aware of it.
Come on. Amen.
I am that bread of life. Your fathers did eat manna in the wilderness, but they're dead. Get it. Mm-hmm. It isn't the ritual. It isn't the physical thing, the natural thing, the bread. It's symbols.
Right.
They ate, but they're dead.
Right.
So you can eat and still be dead. You can eat and still be sick.
Right.
You can take communion and still have all the same problems you had before you took the communion. If you don't know what it is he's talking about.
Come on.
This is the bread which comes down from heaven that a man may eat thereof and not die.
Amen. Come on.
I am the living bread.
Amen. Which
came down from heaven, and if any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world.
His disciples even said, "What? This guy's nuts." The rabbis and the others that were hanging around when Jesus was talking about that said, "What did he think? We're cannibals? We're going to eat his flesh?" He's saying, "I'm going to die. And if you can receive that, you can have everything that purchases, that death, burial, and resurrection purchases for you. It becomes your inheritance.
Come on.
But you've got to eat it. You've got to get it in you. You've got to digest it. You've got to make it a part of you."
Yeah.
Amen.
"Eat my flesh. Drink my blood." We speak the word. We speak Jesus. We're not speaking verbiage. This isn't just vocabulary. We're speaking Christ. We're manifesting. We're incarnating. The word is life. So what did Jesus mean when he said man doesn't live by bread alone? Of course, he's talking about physical bread. But on every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Here's another little nugget here. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God.
Mm-hmm.
It came forth from God to manifest God.
Yes. Amen. Come on.
That's the reason for the written Word, so that we can do what God did. By speaking, releasing Christ into the atmosphere.
Come on.
An incarnation. He's born again. He's alive. He's released. All that reality becomes our reality. The manna of God's word keeps us alive in every area of our life. It strengthens us. It directs us. It's provision for everything. He is the food that keeps us alive in the wilderness.
Yes, Lord.
See, Jesus wasn't speaking hypothetically. He was God in the flesh.
Yes.
But he put aside his privileges as God, and the scripture says he took on the form of a servant, a human. He took on the form of a human.
Mm-hmm.
Why? So that he would have to totally depend on God.
Yes.
That's what we're talking about here.
Yes.
Believing. You can't totally depend on something you don't have total confidence in.
Come on.
That's why the need for constantly being aware of this risen Savior living in us, always there, always providing manna for what manna's for whatever you gotta have, for whatever you're needing. It might be healing today. Next week it might be some income, some financial help. The next time it might be a relational issue. You know, it can be anything. Whatever that thing is, that's what the manna is for. It's Jesus. He's the manna. John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. Jesus gave the Word, was the Word, fed on the Word. It was his life. It was his whole reality. We have received the Word. We have received the manna. We have received Christ. It is our life. That's what he tells us. All right, Deuteronomy 32. Deuteronomy 32, verses 46 and 47. See why I was lighting up here at the beginning? I'm not mad. I'm just excited. Praise the Lord. And he said unto them, "Set your hearts unto all the words which I testify among you this day, which ye shall command your children to observe to do all the words of this law. For it is not a vain thing for you, because it is your life. Through this thing ye shall prolong your days in the land, whether you go over Jordan to possess it." We're talking about types and shadows. This is Old Testament. But it's talking about Jesus. It's just doing it in a type and a shadow. The law, the word of God, is what he's talking about. But that was really Jesus. It was all a foreshadow. It was all so we look at it and go, we've got to do all this stuff. No, he already fulfilled all of that. We have to trust him. We have to believe in him. You see what I'm saying?
Come on.
This was a type and a shadow. Which is so much of everything we do, isn't the reality It's the metaphor. It's the type and the shadow, and we start making that the reality and forget about what the thing was trying to tell us in the first place.
Exactly.
And then what happens? You got religion and no reality, no real manifestation, no real incarnation. You know, there's different eating disorders, you know, but there's those same disorders are typical in Christianity. And one of them is where people become anorexic because they just don't eat. Mm-hmm. Right?
Right.
And you could walk into most churches and find anorexic Christians.
Yes.
Spiritual anorexia. Yep. Distracted by all the problems.
Yeah.
Fearful. Doubting. Wasting away. The real life, the true life that they had, being wasted. Look at John again, if you will, back to John 6. This time we'll start at verse 53 through 58. John 6, 53 through 58. Then said Jesus said unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoso eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood hath eternal life, and I'll raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is meat indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood dwelleth in me, and I in him. You see what I'm saying? What all this is about, right? As the living Father has sent me, and I live by the Father, so he that eateth me, even he shall live by me. This is that bread which came down from heaven, not as your fathers did eat manna and are dead. He that eateth of this bread shall live forever.
Amen.
If you can, skip down to verse 63. It is the Spirit that quickeneth. The flesh profiteth nothing. The ritual doesn't do a thing.
Right.
It's what the ritual represents, a spiritual reality. Mm-hmm. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life.
Yes.
Focus on Jesus. Mm-hmm. Trust what he says.
Yes.
Speak his words. Agree with him. He's in you. He's a part of you. You and he are one. His life is in you. You are in him.
Glory.
There's another eating disorder called bulimia. And that is the old binge and purge. Eat and then vomit. You get the fun of eating, but you don't have to deal with the after effects of gaining weight. And it has a spiritual aspect as well. James chapter 1, verses 22 through 25. Be ye doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. You see the analogy here with what I'm talking about with communion. And again, don't misunderstand me. I'm not against communion. I'm just saying communion is not what it's about. Communion is pointing us to something else.
Right.
For if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he's like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass, for he beholdeth himself and goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the word, this man shall be blessed in his deed. Eating, going away to purge, and forgetting what manner of man we are. Becoming bulimic. We're not just interested in more information. We've got more information than most of us can digest already. But we're looking for transformation. Matthew chapter 15, verse 11. This will be my last scripture. Not that which goeth into the mouth defileth a man, but that which cometh out of the mouth, that's what defiles us.
Mm-hmm.
That's bulimia. That's taking in all kinds of stuff and then throwing up the good stuff. What's supposed to be keeping us alive and feeding us and strengthening us and restoring us. Oh no, this is horrible. This bad thing is going to happen. It's getting worse. Things aren't getting any better. Right? We're supposed to look and see Jesus and see ourselves transformed by beholding him.
Yes.
We look at him, we see ourselves momentarily, and then we turn around and forget who we are. And we purge everything that we've just ingested.
Come on.
Of the truth of God.
Come on.
And wonder why we waste, why we aren't strong, why we don't have vigor, and why we don't have courage and boldness when in the face of the enemy. Because we're weak.
Come on.
Feed on Jesus. Feed on the Christ that's in you.
Yes, Lord.
Feed on being one with God. That's how we survive in the wilderness. The old saying's true. We really are what we eat.
Yep.
Let's, whenever we do this, do it to remember him.
Yes.
And what he's already done for us.
Yes.
So whether you do it once a week, whether you do it 5 times a day, whether you do it once a year, is really irrelevant.
Right.
What's important is that you know the reason for doing it in the first place.
Yes, Lord.
It's a finished work. It's a after the fact remembrance. We celebrate Christmas. Jesus isn't going to get born again December 25th. We're celebrating something that's already happened.
Right.
It doesn't even matter that it's not the day that it happened.
Right.
Right?
Right.
But what has the world done? It's turned that into the reality and forgot all about what it stands for.
Right.
Again, that's what I'm saying. That's what humans do. That's why the emphasis is always to get us back to Jesus and the finished work of the cross. To see ourselves as we are seen in him. To live our lives from that reality. Look, we're all flawed. We're all screwed up. We all make mistakes. We all do really ignorant things sometimes. Well, maybe there's a couple of you here that aren't. But I'm not sure I know who you are. But I do know me. And I know I need a constant reminder of my reality. Because I'm turning for the mirror all the time and I'm seeing something that isn't in the mirror.
Yeah.
And that wants to define me. I have to constantly go back to the reality of what Jesus has already done and who I am in Christ. Otherwise, I'm getting robbed of all of the strength, all of the power, all of the energy, all that Jesus did and provided for me. Manna becomes a ritual instead of a person. Instead of a reality in my life, it becomes a symbol.
Come on.
With no substance, with no strength, with no power.
Jesus.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
I told you, I'm a perfectionist with a procrastinator complex. Someday, I'm going to be awesome. Praise the Lord. It ought to be today.
Come on.
Let's quit putting off our lives and what Jesus has already done for us. Quit waiting for something other to happen, waiting for another special service or this thing or that thing. It's not that we shouldn't have all that, but we are all procrastinators as humans. We always, tomorrow, I got stuff I got to do now, you know? I got other things I got to deal with. I mean, I got a lot of problems I got to deal with right now. I can't be accepting all that Jesus has already done for me. I got too much to do. I mean, you see what I mean? It's crazy, but that's the way it is. That's what we do. He's the bread of life. And if we eat him, we never die. Our needs are met. Whatever your wilderness is today, do what Jesus did. Feed on him. Feed on that word. Feed on that truth. Feed on that reality, because that's who you are. And you know what the scripture says? The devil fleed him.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. All the devil can take is the real bread, the physical bread. He can't take the spiritual bread. He has no spiritual strength. All he can do is manipulate your carnality, your flesh.
Right.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Give the Lord a big hand.
Yeah. Thank you, God.
Amen, amen. You're just way more than you realize. So much more. And the world wants to keep putting you through these little hoops and jumping little things and doing this and always raising the bar and trying to get you to focus on stuff instead of on the reality of Christ in you, the hope of glory, the oneness of God in you, and the power that that releases when a person is aware of it is the same power that raised Jesus from the dead.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. It's more than atomic power. It's life-giving power and life-sustaining power.
Amen.
God bless all of you. Have a great week. Drive careful going home. It's supposed to melt, and it'll all be just wet and soggy, so it's all good. God bless you.